This is our first tape for defending knife attacks. In training, we do not want to use real knives, real edge weapons. What we would like to use is training equipment that is as realistic as possible on one hand, and on the other hand, will not hurt our partner. Let's demonstrate first and inspect the way that the opponent, the way that the attacker in realistic conditions in the street may attack us. The first grip, an upward strike, upward attack with the knife. The knife is held when the sharp side is sticking, the blade is sticking out from the thumb side. The way of attacking with this is usually recoiling the hand backwards and then driving forward, striking towards the lower section of the opponent. This is the way the attacker will attack. He will attack this way with the right hand, or maybe with the left hand, if he's left-handed. He may be even attacking more in an angle strike. The second type of strike and hold is the regular, the ice pick stab. This time the knife is sticking out from the side of the pinky. The attacker will usually use this type of movement, recoiling the hand backwards and then driving forward, striking towards the upper part, such as the neck, the upper chest, collarbones. The next one is a straight stab. The attacker may hold it in the knife in different ways. The major thing is that the angle of the stab, the way he's attacking, is a straight forward. His hand travels in a straight line towards the target. He may have the left leg forward, striking with the backhand, or he may have the right leg forward, the same as the attacking hand. The last grab that we will handle in this tape is what's called a slash. This time, the knife can move usually in the opponent's hand, and he may attack while driving the knife from side to side, trying to cut, not just to straight stab with a point, but trying to cut the body, the area that he's aiming at. If he has a one-edged knife, he will maybe do one and two, turning the edge. If not, he may be going back in the same direction that he came. Let's examine a little bit the attitude and the mental state of the attacker. Of course, it may happen that the attacker would like to attack one time and then maybe run away. But in our training, we must take into consideration the more difficult problem. When the attacker is not just attacking one time, he attacks over and over again. So, an attacker in, in the heat of the moment may attack few times, such as like this. And we must take into consideration the attack itself, but also what comes after it, such as other attacks. In this tape, we will deal with a simple, relatively simple problems, such as how to deal with multiple attacks. In other tapes, we will present more difficult and advanced problems and relevant solutions. When we look with an overall view about the knife attacks and defending knife attacks, we must understand that if it is possible to prevent the attack, if it's possible to prevent any contact between us, between the attacker and the defender, we must try and do this. So for instance, if you see the danger from a relatively long distance, and you have the time and the ability and the possibility to run away, and that's the appropriate thing to do, do so. Sometimes, what you'll have to do is maybe against an attack, make a defense, run away. It would be, if it's good enough, if it saves yourself, if you're being saved by this, if that's the correct solution, use this only. If you need to defend and counterattack, so the attacker is coming, you make a defense, you make a counterattack, and this by itself serves the purpose, and then you can run away, move away from the danger zone, excellent, do this. But if you cannot move away, if it's impossible to run away, then what you have to do is use counterattacks, so the attacker will not be able to counterattack again. So he will not be able to use the knife again. This can be in different scenarios. For instance, you're in a place that you cannot run away easily from, or you have someone with you that you would like to defend, and if you run away, this person stays in the place and he may be attacked and severely injured. So if there's a need, and the way we are teaching in this video, you must counterattack several times until the opponent cannot continue with his actions. Remember, it's knife attacks. And from what we know, our experience in Israel, in the States, traveling and teaching around the world, many people die from knife attacks. Usually the attacker again is attacking a few times, not just once and then he's going away. No, when he wants to finish a person, he's going to attack multiple attacks. So one has to prevent this. One has to have a very strong counter attacks to a sensitive point in the opponent's body, and then the attacker will not be able to continue with his actions. We are using the defenses. We have the body defense, we have the hand defense to prevent the first attack from coming and hitting us. Then we talked about the counter attacks as early as possible. Sometimes the counter attack serves as a defense if you talk about long distance and you strike, kick the opponent at long distance. But after the counter attacks that you do, what then? The answer is simple. One, go move away, if it's possible. Leave the danger zone very quickly. And two, if you cannot do that, you do not want the weapon to stay in the opponent's hand. You would like to have possession of the weapon. So we have disarming. Now again, disarming is when the opponent cannot really function, cannot resist. He cannot attack you, He cannot punch you, he cannot kick you, he cannot stab you. It is important to understand this, that disarming is really when the opponent cannot do much. Then you can take the knife away from him, and we teach how to do that. Next area, we're going to deal with hand defenses against knife attacks. But we want to make you very aware of this fact, that people who are victims of knife attacks often are never aware that they're being attacked by someone who possesses an edged weapon. They only become aware of that fact afterwards by either the nature of their injuries or the discovery of a knife at a crime scene. We must build effective hand defenses. Like we've seen in 360-degree defense, they must be effective not only just against punches, but if someone also has a weapon in their hand, like a knife, a screwdriver, or some other sharp object. We work on this drill, the 360-degree defense exercise, with a knife in the hand to make sure that, first of all, we have our weight in the correct place, that we're stopping the threat, the stab, at a 90-degree angle, that if possible, we try to defend with our wrist at the attacker's wrist for measures of control later on. We also want to make sure that our defense is broad enough, goes outside enough, that as the knife travels inside of the defense, it does not reach our body. Michael will demonstrate slowly a brief introduction to this type of training method. In this position, I'm making a downward type stab, first of all, to Michael's neck or clavicle hollow area. The stab is very strong, and if Michael were to make a defense with a straight arm, the stab could be redirected to another vital part of his body. It's crucial that Michael makes the defense at a 90-degree angle to stop the attack, like we've seen in 360-degree defense. They must be effective not only just against punches, but if someone also has a weapon in their hand, like a knife, a screwdriver, or some other sharp object. We work on this drill, the 360-degree defense exercise, with a knife in the hand to make sure that, first of all, we have our weight in the correct place, that we're stopping the threat, the stab, at a 90-degree angle, that if possible, we try to defend with our wrist at the attacker's wrist for measures of control later on. We also want to make sure that our defense is broad enough, goes outside enough, that as the knife travels inside of the defense, it does not reach our body. Michael will demonstrate slowly a brief introduction to this type of training method. In this position, I'm making a downward type stab, first of all, to Michael's neck or clavicle hollow area. The stab is very strong,
And if Michael were to make a defense with a straight arm, the stab could be redirected to another vital part of his body. It's crucial that Michael makes the defense at a 90-degree angle to stop the attack without causing any sliding. Notice how far his hand is extended to keep the blade away from his body, how he puts his head and neck inside to protect from being cut. When the angle changes to more of a sideward angle to the neck, Michael goes out. He goes out so far that the blade does not come around the defense and cut his body. In a lower position, from this position, when I am stabbing here, Michael also stops the attack at a 90-degree angle, not allowing it to slide. From this position, his straight legs keep vulnerable areas like his torso, stomach, and groin area further away from the blade of the knife. In this final position, a vertical upward stab at a very sharp angle, Michael too creates the 90-degree defense far away from his body, keeping his legs straight and the target areas away from the blade. His weight is in the defense at every place to ensure an effective and very practical defense. This exercise should be performed with the knife in both hands so we work the full 360-degree defense range. We now view the 360-degree defense exercise against the knife at full speed. We now view the 360-degree defense exercise applied to the knife defenses. In this scenario, Michael will be both defending against the knife stab, but also offering a counterpunch to stop the second attack. Now Michael will offer other counterattacks, such as knees. Notice the similarity between these defenses and our defenses against the vertical upward and vertical downward stabs. In this scenario, we deal with an attacker that's armed with a knife. We're dealing with an attacker that's delivering the attack in an ice pick downward type motion. It's a very strong stab in that the weight is being delivered forward and down. Often the attack is accompanied by a series of repetitious type of stabbing motions. John will be demonstrating how to defend against the exercise. He will be making a hand defense similar to what you've seen in the combative section in the 360-degree defense exercise series. But he will also be making a simultaneous counterattack. The counterattack will interfere with my ability to stab more than once. In this view, we can see the defense in its stages. The attacker moves towards John, raising the knife and delivering the stab. John is defending at the wrist area of the arm holding the knife. Simultaneously, he's delivering a counterattack to the chin. He will follow up with other counterattacks, grabbing and delivering the knee. Continuing to rotate the hand up, securing the wrist area, creating leverage on the back of the hand, digging his fingers into the palm of the attacker's hands, and stripping the knife away. At this point, he can kick or offer other counterattacks or retreat. Again, the stab in the defense with a counterattack, grabbing and securing the hand holding the knife, grabbing the upper torso of the attacker. Knees delivered to the midsection, to the face, bringing the hand holding the knife up, palm up, creating leverage on the wrist, digging the fingers in, and stripping the knife away. Additional counterattacks can be given before retreating from the scene. It's important to note that this exercise can be performed in varying states of readiness. John is close to his attacker and is responding when he isn't quite ready to even notice what is happening. He's making an instinctive defense with a simultaneous counterattack, the same as viewed from 360-degree defense exercise. Notice the close distance between the attacker and defender. The defense only. The defense is made at a 90-degree angle so the knife cannot slide. John is also delivering a counterattack to the throat or chin area with his defense. Should there be more distance between the defender and attacker, John will be able to step, or a greater state of readiness will also allow John to step in with his defense. On the issue of controlling the knife hand, John makes his defense and is pushing the knife back and down to his perspective and catching the knife before it is all the way down. Again, slowly, John is defending, pushing the knife back and down, immobilizing it against the attacker, following up with strong counterattacks. Again, with the defense. Defense at a 90-degree angle, pushing the knife back, stepping in, following up with counterattacks. Viewed slowly and continually from this angle, you will watch John just control the knife. Because the stabber will be pulling back to stab again, John must go in and place pressure and weight and catch the hand holding the knife as early as possible. This further restricts and immobilizes the knife so John can counterattack and end up in a position where he's able to disarm the assailant. We now view the defense of an ice pick type stab. Now we break down this defense into its teaching stages. Stage one will be the defense against the stab and a simultaneous counterattack with the hand. The stab is given, John blocks, and gives a simultaneous punch to the throat or chin area. This is repeated. Stage two. Stage one is made. Stage two is stepping in, controlling the knife hand, grabbing the knife hand and bringing it down, immobilizing the knife, also catching at the upper torso. Stage three is the delivery of knee strikes to vulnerable parts of the body. Stage four is the disarming technique. Here, John grabs the wrist area, creates a lock, creates leverage, digs his fingers in, and strips the knife. The next stage is a kick to the groin and a retreat from the scene. In a different angle, stage one, the defense and counterattack. Stage two, stepping in and controlling the knife back and down, immobilizing it. Stage three, the delivery of counterattacks like knee strikes. Stage four is the disarming technique, creating a lock, digging the fingers in against the palm, stripping the knife. The final stage is a further counterattack and retreat with the weapon.
Vertical upward stab is an attack that goes towards your lower section of the body, lower abdomen, going upwards and sometimes even diagonally inward. Let's see Michael dealing with this problem delivered from a relatively short range. Michael takes a passive stance to simulate a non-ready position. He blocks the attack and counterattack immediately. You are meeting the attack in 90 degrees angle to eliminate any sliding of the forearm towards the body. Michael then takes a step diagonally forward and in strongly to grab the opponent's forearm. He's sending his arm forward to trap the opponent's arm. Trapping the arm like is done against a gun from the rear. You can see this in the relevant tape. Michael continues with counterattacks and knee strikes, and then goes to disarm the opponent. Let's see this from the other angle. Defending and counterattacking, going in deep, trapping the opponent's arm, contacting again with the knee strikes, and disarming. And again, a 360 degrees type of defense is used. The knife is away from the body when being stopped. As you stop the attack, you're meeting the forearm of the attacker close to his wrist. To disarm, you grab strongly his hand, bend the wrist, and then insert your fingers in. Grabbing the opponent's back of the hand in order to get out to make the disarm. You're bending the wrist strongly, and then insert your fingers in, grab the knife, and peel it away from the opponent's hand. If you meet any resistance while doing this, you must counterattack again. Let's see the technique in real speed. Note that the practitioners are using forearm guards. First, we're blocking and counterattacking. The counterattack can go to the opponent's chin or throat, bending at the waist in order to stop the attack away from the body and early. After that, in order to control the opponent, we step strongly in with the left leg, trapping the opponent's forearm. The forearm is between our hook hand, forearm, bicep muscles, and chest. After that, we grab the opponent and knee him again. So, one is the defense and counterattack, two, trapping, going in, and giving a knee. After we give the knee, we go to disarming. So one, go in and give a knee, two, turn to grab the opponent's hand, and disarm. As we are dealing with an upward stab, upward strike with a knife, when the attacker is slightly in long range, what we call intermediate range, the defender may have the time to utilize also a body defense, not just use a hand defense. Let's see Marnie demonstrating these techniques. As Michael starts his attack from the intermediate range, Marnie is closing in. She makes a step diagonally forward while using the hand defense. The hand defense leads the body defense. From here we can clearly see how Marnie was moving away diagonally sideways from the line of attack. From the punch, you retreat, recoil, and go to the opponent's hand. Grab it firmly, switch the position of your heels, and strike to the groin. As you do this, you bend the opponent's wrist strongly, then slide in and insert your fingers in. Strip the opponent's hand, take the knife away from him. Let's see this technique in a realistic, natural speed. The trainees are using protective gear, forearm pads, for their safety. Let's take the technique by its components and stages. First, we have the hand defense. It's a type of defense used in the 360 degrees outside defenses, stopping the attacker's forearm relatively close to his body. We have the body defense. It's turning, moving away from the line of the attack. We combine these two movements with step strongly forward to meet the attack in an early stage of it. We add now a counterattack as we are grabbing the opponent's wrist to eliminate any reuse of the knife. Our forearm does not let the opponent's forearm slide towards our body. The position of our elbow in relation to his elbow enables us to do so. From this stage, we grab the opponent's hand, switch the position of the heels as the second stage. And again, first stage, defense and counterattack. Second stage, grab, switch position of the heels and kick. The third stage will be the disarming. And again, Look how Mani uses a body in the disarming process, bending strongly the opponent's wrist.
We now deal with a straight stab attack that's being offered at an intermediate distance. Marnie will defend. We now view this defense from various angles and at a relatively slow rate of speed. First, just the defense itself. Marnie is making the defense, the counterattack, securing the hand that's holding the knife, and then stripping the knife away. If we look just at the defense itself, you see that Marnie is making an inside defense similar to inside defenses against a right punch. She is defending at the back of the knife hand, causing the earliest possible redirection of the line of attack. As she is doing that, she is rotating her hand sharply inward in a chopping-like motion to cause a sharp defensive action, redirection of the line of attack. She slides up the arm and traps the arm so that it cannot stab again. Her elbow is lower than the stabbing arm to prevent slashing from occurring. And of course, the thing that helps us defend against second and third stabs is an immediate counterattack. This counterattack interferes with the attacker's ability to stab a second, third, or subsequent times. The punch also allows Marnie to then secure the knife hand by covering it with her opposite hand, creating a lock or leverage on the wrist, and straightening her arms and kicking to the groin sharply. Up to that point, the defense, the control, countered both in the punch and to the kicking to the groin. At that point, Marnie can strip the knife away and retreat from the scene. It is also possible for Marnie just to make a defense, a counterpunch, and push off, leaving the scene, picking something up in the environment, if that is possible. We now view this exercise from various angles. Notice that when Marnie secures the hand to make the kick, she keeps her arm straight so the knife stays at a far distance from her and does not come close to her when she makes her kick to the groin. The defense at the back of the hand, the kick to the groin, taking the knife and backing out. Notice the timing between the hand defense and the punch, with her weight in both, kicking and then stripping the knife. In this next scene, we break down the exercise into its teaching stages. First, we note that the exercise can be performed from a passive stance, the position that Marnie is in now, or in a more ready position, resembling a fighting stance, but less threatening position. The two positions, the passive stance and this position of readiness, deals with how early we're able to see the threat or the danger and react. But in either case, we do not take a stance that would alert the defender, or alert the attacker rather, that the defender is a trained person. From this position, we'll deal with the first stage in the defense. The first stage in the defense is an inside defense with the forearm. The blocking ranges from the tip of the fingers to the elbow. If it's a lower stab, the forearm closer to the elbow area will make the defense, and notice that Marnie is lowering her body to the level of the stab. When she lowers her body, the blocking range covers a greater percentage of her body for the blocking range. We assume now that the stab is being made to the chest or throat level. Notice how the forearm of the defender comes across and turn sharply inward in a chopping type of action. The defense ideally should be made at the back of the hand holding the knife, the back of the attacker's hand. This deflects the line of the attack away from the defender's body. Now we combine at stage two the hand defense with a sharp body defense. In other words, the body of the defender moves out of the line of the attack in conjunction with the hand defense. This combines for an overall earlier and more complete defense. Stage three, the hand defense and the body defense with an advance and a sharp punch forward. Notice that the hand is grabbing the arm, controlling the knife hand, and the elbow remains sharply down to prevent sliding of the arm in a slashing type of movement back towards the defender. We move in because we know the attacker will recoil his stab. As Marnie goes in, defends, counterattacks, and controls the hand holding the knife, notice that her elbow remains down, preventing the knife from sliding. The next stage, stage four, is for Marnie to make the punch, and she catches the hand with her punching hand, the hand holding the knife. She straightens the hand, creating a lock on the wrist, and makes a kick to the groin area. The double catch on the attacker's hand and the lock with the kick combine for stage four. Notice how Marnie's arms are straight. This will keep the blade of the knife at a further distance from her body so that Marnie does not get cut by the blade. The final stage, stage five, deals with Marnie then, after giving suitable counterattacks, stripping the knife. She creates a greater lock on the wrist, digs her fingers into the palm of the attacker's hands, creates leverage on the wrist, and removes the knife from the hand of the attacker. She's free to move or retreat from the scene. Stages one through five. The hand and body defense. Stepping in for stage two with the punch. Can catching the hand. Stage three is catching the hand and making a counterattack. Stage four is creating the lock, stripping the knife, and retreating from the scene.
We are presenting you now with another set of problems and solutions. We are talking about the problem of the slash. The attacker holds the knife and drives it from side to side. He is trying to cut your throat, your face, your body. He can hold the knife and do it in various manners. What is important is that his action, his movement, hand the knife, is from side to side. Let's see with John how we are dealing with this problem. Understand again that the attacker is trying to cut from side to side this way, one slash or more than one slash. You are going to deal with it in ways that we learned in the combatives. John, as the defender and Wade as the attacker, will demonstrate now for us how to deal with this type of attack. The attacker is slashing towards your upper body. He tries to cut your throat, your face. You must block the attack as early as possible, keeping the knife away from your body. You're defending with the forearm, touching the hand, the wrist, or the forearm of the attacker. The best place to hit, to touch, and defend is the hand of the attacker. With a sharp movement, after the counterattack, you grab and deliver another counterattack. Grabbing the opponent's hand will be beneficial in order to control the knife hand, so the attacker will not be able to redirect the knife and attack with it again. Burying the head between the shoulders protects it more. If you're being surprised, your step will be late. If you are early, you can make a step while defending. We are talking about a distance not appropriate for a kick yet. We demonstrate now the technique in natural speed. In reality, an attacker will usually not attack once. He will attack with more than one attack. For instance, now against a double slash, the attacker is attacking. John is reacting not with the hand defense first, but with the body defense. His natural reaction now is to move back first, while the first slash is coming against his body. Thus, Wade is missing him with the first slash. When Wade is attacking with the second attack, John is ready for it. He is sending two forearms to meet the attacking arm. Blocking the attacking arm in 2 points and then counterattacking. John is blocking, grabbing, counterattacking. We now show the technique in the natural speed. Let's put our attention to the body defense. John is sending his upper body, starting with the head and neck backwards. While doing this, he's raising his hands to his throat and chin level. You can see John's leg moving backwards to facilitate a better body defense, a larger one. Then John comes forward with a step with the forward leg to come closer to the opponent. This is done against the second slash. His forearm defense is pulling his body moving forward. Blocking with the sharp edge of the forearm in a vertical manner to make a large, to defend a large surface. After the defense, you grab the opponent's arm and counterattack. This being done, of course, in a sharp movement. At this point, we have to grab the opponent's hand, switch the position of the legs, and counterattack again with the kick. Let us see this in another angle. Note the way John is grabbing the attacker's hand. We disarm the knife as was taught in the defenses against a straight stance. Grabbing the hand, bending at the wrist, pulling at the left, pushing at the right hand, and disarming the opponent. We demonstrate now the learning stages. First, we start with leaning backwards, raising the hands, and stepping backwards, keeping the back heel up. If our state of readiness and position decides that we will move backwards against the first lash, we do this. If not, we could do the basic first exercise that was defending. Now we do the first thing and then going in. So moving back and stepping in. Stepping in with two forearm defenses, send to meet the attacker's slashing arm. After finishing this first stage, we move to second stage, which is the counterattacks. From here it is the disarming process.
In this next scenario, we deal with an attacker that is making a vertical downward type stab. That type of stab we've been referring to as an ice pick stab. In this scenario, however, there's a great deal of distance between the defender and the attacker. Enough distance so that the defender can operate with his long range weapons. This will be a kicking defense that Michael will demonstrate. Kicking defense is important because, again, we have the luxury of the reach of the leg. It allows us to keep our vulnerable areas of the body further away from the blade of the knife. We now demonstrate this defense slowly. Note the distance between the defender and the attacker. The defender does not take some type of fighting stance. He wants the attacker to feel free to come in. As soon as Wade begins to pull back on the knife to stab forward and step, Michael closes the distance with a bursting step forward, kicking to the groin at a 45 degree angle. This angle of the kick is a punching and also a pushing type of kick that allows Michael to send the attacker's hips backwards, delivering a sharp blow to the groin area. This interrupts the rhythm of the attack, stopping it. Michael can follow up with counterattacks. And now we'll see it from the original angle. As the attack comes, watch Wade is drawing the knife up to time his stabbing to the position where Michael is originally standing. Michael uses that time and that opportunity to close the distance and use his longer range weapons to kick at a 45 degree angle with the ball of the foot, with a straight leg, forcing the hips back and the body back of the attacker, interrupting the attack before the knife is thrust down upon him in his original position. This next scene illustrates the target area being hit by the defender's foot. The kick is rising at a 45 degree angle, and the defender is kicking with the ball of his foot. The foot itself rises at a 45 degree angle up and forward, forcing the attacker's hips back. This interferes with the attacker's ability to send the stab, and it also impedes the attacker's ability to continue his advance towards the defender. In this scene, we'll examine the exercise and break the exercise down into its teaching stages. First, note that the stance that Michael is in, and he will be demonstrating from this stance, is a passive position. He does not assume a fighting stance. This will invite the attack, and the attacker feels free to come in to give the stab. The first stage is an advance. Michael will be advancing forward, but in a diagonal angle. This assumes a right-handed attacker. From this position, Michael is bursting in, and as he bursts in, the inside of his foot turns out slightly to extend the right hip of the kicking leg. This is stage one. Stage two involves making the actual kick. One, then two. One, then two. One, then two. Because the knife is being drawn in an upwards motion, is being held at a relatively high level, our kick is low to a vulnerable target, which is the groin area. Notice the kicking foot is held at a 45 degree angle to push the hips of the attacker back. Michael will now face to his right and make the exercise. Notice the stages, a step and a kick. Michael's hands come up but stay close to him so as not to be cut. It's important to note that Michael's upper body leans backwards. His hip of the kicking leg shoots forward to provide greater distance and reach. The leaning accomplishes this reach, but also helps to keep the vulnerable parts of his body further away from the blade, namely his torso. A final note on this particular exercise. It should be noted that the defender may want to move in a different direction from what we've shown. It is possible to step out with the right leg and kick with the left. The reason for this could be tactical reasons, positioning, or it could be the disbursement of weight at the time the attack is brought to the defender. If the defender's weight is in such a way that it would be appropriate to step to the right and kick with the left, it's fine to do so. One other note. From the original position, it is possible to step out with one leg and kick to a higher target area. This is especially true if the attacker tends to be leaning with his torso and the upper torso is at a closer distance than the groin area. In this next scenario, we deal with an attacker that is stabbing with a vertical upward type stab. What's particularly notable is that the attacker will lower his body and then raise the body with the attack to gain greater power. If the defender can make the defense when the attacker is at a greater distance, the defender will defend with a kicking type of defense, stopping the attack in its place. This will allow the defender to keep the blade of the knife further from vulnerable parts of his or her body. Michael will now demonstrate. In this view, we'll watch the attack. The defense will be performed by Michael, who will be using the reach of his leg to stop the attack when the knife is at a far distance from the body. Michael's foot is coming in an upward and going slightly out from his body, catching the attacker at either the upper torso, the solar plex area, the chin, or even the throat. Whatever is forward, the defender will be kicking. The kick is rising in the center line and will catch the target that's available. Changing the angle, we can see that Michael is at a suitable distance. As soon as the attack begins, Michael starts his advance forward, kicking in an upward motion, catching the attacker before the attack itself can reach Michael. From this position, we'll break down the exercise into its teaching stages. Note that Michael is not in any type of a stance. We want the attacker to feel free to come to us in an aggressive manner to attack. As soon as the attacker is closing distance, Michael is changing slightly the angle of his body and making a body defense, and also changing the line of the kick to come straight up through the center of the body. Step one will be the change of the feet. In stage two, we add the kick itself, the body defense and the kick, the body defense and the kick. It's important to note that this type of stab is delivered with a bent arm. It's also delivered from a relatively low position. This allows Michael to kick when the knife is low to a high position target. Michael's reach in his legs will be longer than the bent arm of the attacker. In this next scenario, we deal with a knife attack where the attacker is issuing a straight stab and covering distance. The distance between the defender and the attacker here is quite a considerable distance. Enough distance, in fact, so that the defender can defend with a long-range front kick that stops the attack in its place. It interferes with the attacker's ability to actually issue the entire attack. Wade will now demonstrate. In this next scenario, we deal with the kicking defense against a straight stab. Notice the distance between the attacker and the defender, the relatively long distance that the attacker must cover in order to reach the intended target. As the attacker comes forward, we offer a rising front kick to the center line of the attacker's body. This will stop the attack in its place, interfere with the progress forward of the attacker, stopping him at a distance where the knife cannot reach our body. Notice also how the defender leans back to remove the vulnerable parts of his body away from the area. while still sending a long-range front kick forward. From this position, the target area, the impact area, on the attacker's body will vary between the timing between the kick and the distance that's being closed. The kick could be offered to the groin area, to the solar plex area, to the throat area, to the face area. It's offered to the center line. Whatever is leaning forward will receive the kick. The kick itself is something between a leg lift and a snapping front kick to ensure the greatest distance and the longest distance possible with the greatest power to stop the attack in its place. In another situation, he is able to advance to close distance to stop the attacker before the knife stab itself can be developed. And it is also possible for him to be in a fight, realizing there's a knife, and to make this defense from a fighting position. In addition, we'll now look at this exercise from various angles with a follow-up counterattack. We now view this defense in slow motion. Look at the timing between the beginning of the stab and the beginning of the defense. The leg is longer than the arm, even with the knife in the hand of the attacker. The timing is such, as soon as we see movement from the attacker, we move with our longer range defense. We are basically attacking with our defense. If we are wearing hard shoes, like a work boot or other type boot, we can kick with our toes. If we are working in softer type shoes, like tennis shoes, we would kick with the ball of the foot at a 45 degree angle. Notice also how Wade's body leans back in order to avoid further any contact with the blade. Of course, additional counterattacks can be made where appropriate. And notice how Wade retreats. It is possible to retreat in order to pick up another object, like a chair that may offer us some measure of defense, or it's possible to retreat entirely from the scene, as is appropriate.
The next technique is another excellent solution to defending against a straight stab, again from a distance. So the attacker holds the knife and stabs straight, but he starts his attack from a distance. He closes in while he's attacking. Let us see first the type of attack that we are talking about. So the attacker moves in and stabs. He stabs to a higher part or midsection. Michael will demonstrate now the technique, the solution. As Wade is attacking with a straight stab, advancing forward, Michael is bailing out. He's moving his body diagonally sideways and forward a little bit to move his body, especially the torso, from the line of attack. As he's doing this, he's delivering a roundhouse kick to the midsection or groin of the opponent, immediately followed by a side kick to the knee of the forward leg. After the two kicks, Michael is ready to counterattack again or to bail out, move out from the danger zone. one house can meet the groin or the solar plexus. We demonstrate now the technique in its learning stages. Michael first will just bail out from the danger line, from the danger zone. Note the angle of his advance diagonally forward. Note at his right hand coming to the opposite side of the neck in order to eliminate any threat that may come to this direction, and also for other uses such as controlling the opponent's hands after the kick. The second stage will be to continue with a kick. So now this is our major move. Bail out and kick. And now we do the whole technique using the second kick also. The second kick can be utilized only if the opponent's leg is close to you. Hope you enjoyed the tape. We are sure that you learned from it. In the future tape of the series dealing with knife attacks, we will be presenting you with other problems and other solutions. We're presenting you also with various knife threats, not just knife stabs, and how to deal with this type of attacks when they are coming from all directions. If someone is by your side attacking you or threatening you from behind, etc. Another thing that is important to remember is the way of training. Start training slow. Put attention to what you're doing. Don't hurt yourself. Don't hurt the other partner you're working with. Use common sense. Think first, do later. Watch at the exercises, watch what the instructors, what the trainees are doing in the exercises, and then follow up stage by stage. Again, remember, use your common sense and train gradually, elevating slowly the speed and strength of the attack.
Krav Maga training seminars, instructor programs, apparel, Krav Maga services and merchandise, Visit our website at www.KravMaga.com.